the ushers a favor, pass out palms so that we can stand in the Christian tradition. Palm Sunday, at the end of worship, we raise our palms and we thank God and praise God like they did centuries ago. And so we stand in that Christian tradition. Hear now the word of God. From the Gospel of Luke, beginning with verse 29 of chapter 19. Chapter 19, verse 29. Luke 19 and 29. Hear now these words. As he approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you why you are untying it, tell them the Lord needs it." And those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, his owner asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They replied, "The Lord needs it." And they brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. And as they went along, the people spread their cloaks on the road. And when he came near to the place where the road was down, where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully praising God in a loud voice for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace on earth and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." If they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. I want to talk about, can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. Several years ago, the Florida Mass Choir had a song that says, "I can't stop praising his name." They repeated it, "I just can't stop praising his name." If you confess the Lord, call him up. And they would say on and on again, "But I just can't stop praising his name." Palm Sunday is a reminder of what worship ought to be about. It's a reminder of what God has done for us and what God means to us. And so, on this Palm Sunday, there are several contrasts in this text. Some in the crowd were there to promote their own agenda. They thought Jesus was there merely to defeat Rome, and so they had no idea that not only was he going to defeat Rome, but he was going to defeat the devil's grip on their lives. And so some cheered Jesus for all the wrong reasons. But then there's another interesting point in this passage, is that God always has some folk that will freely and unequivocally support his ministry. Jesus tells them, he says, "Now I want you to go into the city." And he says, "When you get to the city, you're going to find a colt that has never been ridden. And if the owner asks you what you're doing, just tell the owner that the Lord has need of it." This week I was up in DeKalb and getting our car repaired, and was there at the dealership that Reverend Page works at. And if you ever go up there, you'll notice that there is this silver Corvette that sits on the floor. And it, oh, you're talking about decked out, it has everything. And I called myself just being amused for a little while until I saw that $96,000 price tag that it has in the windshield. And I got tickled as I was thinking about that, and I said, now what if I would come up here and tell Ryan the owner, Ryan the Lord had need of this silver Corvette. And I went to get the keys and I got in it, and I said, now Ryan, the Lord told me to tell you that he has need of this. Now you and I both know, even Reverend Page would have said, now wait a minute, Reverend, wait a minute. I understand what the Lord got need of, but this is the vet. Imagine this man having his modern day equivalent of a new cult that had never been written. And here are his disciples showing up untying his cult. And they said, the man said, now what are you doing? Only thing he told them was that the Lord had need of him. Now can we be honest? How many of y'all would have been so kind? You just bought that nice new car. It's sitting out in front. Some folks show up claiming that they are representing the Lord, and the Lord has need of it. It don't even have to be a new car, does it? It could be your hoopty that's sitting out there, and somebody show up and say, and the Lord has need of it. You don't have to tell me the words that's forming in your mind right now. The Lord always has somebody that will freely and unequivocally do his bidding. But there's another strange thing about this text. And that is, it says that as Jesus came into the city, the people started to praise him. The people started to worship him. What is interesting, it says, here's why they started to worship him. Verse 37, it says, when he came near to the place where the road goes down to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles, for all the blessings, for everything that he has done for them. They said, like Florida Mass Choir, I just can't stop praising his name. You know, life kind of numbs us at some point. And at some times we move beyond the blessing. You know, it's easy when you're sick and you're in the hospital and you say, Lord, if I can just get well. And you see the Lord touch your body and you see the Lord bring things together. And all of a sudden, while you're in the hospital, you say, Lord, I just want to thank you. Yes. But you know, life can make you numb to God's goodness after a while. Yes, after 3 or 4 months out of the hospital and you're feeling okay and you're back to work. And it seems like maybe it was just modern technology. Maybe it was just medical technology that got you where you ought to be. And so you're at work, and then, God forbid, you show up at church. Okay. Your concern at church is, when will Bedford sit up, shut up, and sit down so we can go to dinner? Isn't it odd that as time goes on, that we can forget about God's grace and mercy in our lives? Isn't it strange how we can come to church and assume that all of our blessings are for our doing, our manipulation, our networking? We can easily come to church and sit in church as if it's a spectator sport. And have no praise. And have no worship. We can even leave church and get on the phone and say, well, you know, the choir didn't do that hot today. Pastor, I don't know what he was talking about. Because we can easily forget how God has blessed us. I want you to know that your praise is not contingent upon how the choir sings. I want you to know that your praise is not contingent upon how well the preacher preaches. Your praise is not contingent upon who prays or who doesn't pray. Your praise is contingent upon how God has worked in your life. You look back over your journey and see what the Lord has done for you. These folks said they praised God for the miracles that they have seen. They praise God for how God has impacted their life. Now I'm almost done. But is there anybody here got a praise report? Is there anybody here this morning that said, "Preacher, here's why I just can't stop praising the Lord. For in my life, I've had some folk to count me out. In my life, I didn't know some nights how I was going to make it. And God showed up and it showed out." Is there anybody here today? Said, "I know what it's like to be counted out. I know what it's like." Somebody here can say, "I know what it's like to be sick and the Lord make a way." You see, Palm Sunday is a model for worship. Palm Sunday says that I've got something to raise my palm about today. I've got a testimony. I've got a story. I've been impacted by the risen Savior. See, if you're not careful, the devil will give you spiritual amnesia. If you're not careful, you'll forget about how the Lord prevented that car accident. If you're not careful, you'll forget about that on Monday when I show up at work, that I keep becoming protected even when folk there may not like it. If you're not careful, you'll look back over your journey, and some of you know that he's brought you from Mississippi with nothing, and you're here in Chicagoland with a little something. If you're not careful, you'll think that you just got yourself out the hood, and you never pause to say, "Lord, I've got to thank you for being God all by yourself." I feel like preaching. It's on Palm Sunday. Now there's always haters of the crowd. There's always somebody who's gonna say, "Why don't she just sit down?" Blocking my view, all that shouting, carrying on. "Why don't you just go somewhere and behave yourself? Do you not know that even in watching sports, that there's a tendency to root for the team that you like?" Just this week, I was watching Middle Tennessee State University in March Madness. I figured since we've invested in them, at least we can do is cheer for them. My son goes to school down there, and everybody had counted them out. No way in the world that you can beat the mighty Michigan State. The Spartans. I know, I may have some Michigan State fans here. And I'm not trying to gloat. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. But most folk have never heard of MTSU. Who are they? They walked on the court, and at the end, they won the game. Now let me tell you something. Whenever they got behind, I'm confessing you, y'all. I said some things. And I have to repent. But then the name got ahead. I couldn't help myself. I couldn't stand up and just say, go, Blue Raiders. And then when they won, you could hear me three doors down. But yeah, for some, we come to church.
All right.
And we will expend more energy at a Cubs game. We will expend more energy at a Bears game than to say, I just got to stand up and testify about what the Lord has done for me. How he's brought me from a mighty long way. I know you've got your Sunday best on, and I know you've got your college education, but every now and then you ought to say, Lord, I'm going to raise my palms. I'm going to say thank you for being God all by yourself. I know I'm living in the suburbs, and I know I'm driving something shiny, but if it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? So the haters came along. The haters came along. They said, now, Jesus, here's what you need to do. You need to tell your disciples that they need to be quiet. Yes, they have seen the miracles that we could not have done. But you need to tell your disciples that they need to be quiet. I love his response. He says, well, they can't help themselves. They can't help themselves. I like being in worship with some folk who say, Pastor, if you only knew my story, if you only knew my journey, if you only knew the ups and downs that I've had to deal with, if you only knew the rejection that I've had to come up against, if you only knew my story. And so, Pastor, I just can't help myself. Every now and then, there may be some of you that may be convinced that your sophistication is on the line, that they're going to vote you out of the hall of sophistication if you get your praise on. That maybe somebody will hear about it in the boardroom on Monday and think that you have lost your mark because you just let a hand go up and say, Lord, thank you. Maybe you want folk to think that all of your kids have gotten a college education because you worked so hard. And maybe you want to believe that all that you have is from your own sweat and tears. So you can sit here and be calm, cool, and collected. But I just want to remind you this morning that if the Lord hadn't given you breath every day, you couldn't have done what you've done. That if the Lord had not have made a way out of no way, that if the Lord had not have opened some doors that no man could shut, that if the Lord not, had not had some folk praying for you, that maybe you don't even know it. Grandmama is petitioning on your behalf. Auntie is at the throne petitioning on your behalf. Granddaddy is around the throne petitioning on your behalf. The Father is looking down and saying, what can I do to help my servant? Jesus said, but if they refuse, if they come to church quiet, calm, cool, and collect, part of the frozen chosen, Jesus said, that's all right. Let them show up on Barnes Road and look at you like you're crazy. That's all right. Because I've got some rocks in the parking lot. I've got some stones in the parking lot. That if they don't say, God, I thank you. Help, I've got some rocks on Barnes Road that'll say, Lord, thank you for the sun you let have on me. Thank you for last night's lying down. Thank you for this morning's the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Is there anybody in the house today that can lift up your palm and say, Lord, I thank you. It may not be what I want to be, but I praise you that I'm not what I used to be. Journey that the Lord has brought you through. You've been delivered from something. You've been helped by some folk. There comes a time in your worship that you say, look, I didn't come to church for pretty worship. I come to church because I know what the Lord has done. I come to church to say, you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. The cancer survivors say, you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. The one that's been through the legal system and survived, you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. So I say to you this morning, on Palm Sunday, take time to say, Lord, I just want to thank you. I just want to praise you. They said they praised him because of what they have seen. They said they praise God because they have seen the miracle in their lives. Some of you are a walking miracle today. Some of you folks said you wasn't going to be nothing. Couldn't make nothing out of yourself. And the Lord said, what I've anointed, get your hands off. What I bless, you are blessed. How do you know that what God has for you is just for you? Oh, I praise him today. I praise him on Palm Sunday. I thank him on Palm Sunday. We're going to lift up our palms. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He'll rise from the dead. Next Sunday, he'll tell you, I got all power in my hand. Let's praise him a while. Let's thank him for his goodness.
Based on a Christian experience. If you
you're visiting in our city, you can join in the Watch Care. You need a spiritual home. You need a place where you could come. And as we began Holy Week, a time of prayer, if you say, Pastor, I want to begin Holy Week, would you pray for me? Our altar is open for you right now. If you want to come to this altar for prayer, the altar is open for you right now. I believe. Commitment.